So we will start with constipation. Constipation sounds like a very simple topic or something which we don't think as a topic itself to discuss. But when you come to palliative care patients, we will see constipation as a regular issue with the patient, and one of the symptoms which is often overlooked or usually not explored well. Because patients very rarely come to you with constipation per se. They'll come with associated symptoms, but very rarely they come and complain of constipation per se. So today we will be talking about what exactly is constipation and why should we discuss constipation taking so much of time, and what are the reasons and how can we manage the constipation. So the constipation, like any other symptom, is also very subjective. Like it depends on the previous bowel habits. Some people would have had a regular bowel opening every day or two times a day. So we cannot just tell that this person is not constipated, that person is constipated. So what exactly is constipation? The feces will be small volume and passing infrequently and with difficulty. There will be a lot of strain involved in passing fecal matter. Persistent, so I have underlined that in red, the words persistent, difficult, infrequent, or at last seemingly incomplete defecation. Although they had a bowel opening, but it seems to be incomplete defecation. These words are really important because only when you ask specifically these words, we will be able to find out whether the patient is having constipation or not. I can very confidently say that it is a very the most mismanaged symptom, because there are a lot of misconceptions even among professionals that we tend to relate the quantity and the frequency of bowel opening to the amount of food intake or the diet per se. And the moment you ask about do you have normal bowel opening, the moment you ask that, the patient and the caregiver will say, yeah, we are drinking only juice and coconut water, no solid food, so it is okay. So what happens in a fecal matter? Is it just the rice and chapati that you eat comes out? No, there are so many other things that need to be come out. So that is a most frequently used explanation by the patients, by the caregivers, and very unfortunately by the professionals also. It's okay anyway, you are not eating, and it's okay. And we ignore the psychological factors, like many a times, especially in patients with paraplegia or any other neurological issues where they don't have control over the bowel opening, they feel embarrassed to depend on others to clean themselves and everything. So they prefer to be constipated rather than having a regular bowel opening. And privacy is a major issue when they are admitted in a hospital, especially when they are in a general ward or even otherwise. When the nurse has to, or your caregiver has to take you to the toilet and they have to stand near you because you are too weak to handle on your own. So then the privacy issues are a lot. So the patients prefer to be constipated than having a breach in privacy. And many of the times, even the professionals, we overlook the side effects. We think it's just a constipation. He's suffering from such a big issue, an advanced illness, and what is there to look into a constipation matter? But no, constipation can be the sole reason for most of the symptoms that they come to us. And even sometimes we prescribe suboptimal doses, or sometimes they take less doses. The moment you prescribe laxatives, they are worried about having a loose stool episode. So what they do is, like, they instead of 2 tablets, they may take one, or instead of 15 ml, they may take 5 ml, because they're really worried about having a loose stool episode, and then they become tired. Anyway, I'm not eating, so it's okay that if I don't have this kind of bowel opening. So that is one other reason. And very often they come with atypical presentation. They come to you with dyspeptic symptoms, or they may come to you with urinary tract infection or urinary retention, or even confused state, which mimics very likely, very, very well to delirium. especially in elderly patients, when they have a constipation history, they come to us with a confused state or a delirious manner. And it is not uncommon. It is a very common presentation to a palliative care OPD. We see that very, very regularly. Patient developing sudden onset of confused state, and then you ask about the bowel habits, then he must be constipated for more than a few days. And very often they present with overflow diarrhea. So they may come up with a complaint of loose stools. And then the moment we hear the loose stool, we start prescribing loperamide or something so that they'll stop having that loose stool episode. But that will be usually very, very commonly overflow diarrhea. So what happens then, you are making the patient constipated again. So I'll come to you again with the overflow diarrhea. So this is a very commonly used criteria, Rome criteria. For the theoretical purpose, it is good to know the Rome criteria. The patient should satisfy at least two or more of the following. And you can read more, at least 25% of defecation they strain, or mostly more than 25% of time they have anorectal obstruction. That something is obstructed over there. And more than 25% of the time, they have very hard and lumpy stools. And less than 3 bowel movements per week. So they should satisfy at least 2 or more of the following criteria. This is for our idea that we should focus on the strain. We don't need to think 25% or anything, that calculation, because if you're doing a study for a research purpose, then this is very relevant. But otherwise, you can think straining, whether there is any straining, whether there is a feeling of anorectal obstruction, whether the stools are hard and lumpy, and how many bowel opening per week. So if they come across most of these, then you can say the patient is constipated. And in advanced illness, what is the problem when they are constipated? They may come up with colicky abdominal pain, and then you struggle a lot to manage the pain. Then patient will tell you, I don't have, they are anorexic. Most of them have anorexia cachexia syndrome in advanced stage of cancer. And again, constipation adds on to that anorexia. They'll have nausea and vomiting, which we discussed last week. Prolonged constipation can cause nausea and vomiting. And we know that how closely the rectum and the bladder is situated. So it can very, very commonly lead to urinary retention. Anxiety, elderly people, if they don't have their usual bowel opening pattern, then they'll be really anxious. Why is it happening? And very, very commonly confusion and delirium in elderly. And it is not an uncommon scenario that the moment we relieve constipation without any medication, they'll come back to their normal unconfused state just with managing constipation. And what are the causes in our setting? Most of the drugs that we prescribe, we discussed about a lot of drugs last week and even during the pain management, right? So most of the drugs that we use in palliative care, like antacids, anti-epileptics, we use as adjuvants. Many of the antiemetics like ondansetron or anticholinergic drugs, we use a lot of opioids, antidepressants. So most of these medications can cause constipation. And we know that our patients will be dehydrated and a lot of metabolic issues like hyponatremia, hypercalcemia, hypokalemia. Everything can be associated, can be a reason for constipation. And we know that spinal cord compression, constipation would be one of the very last or the very important prognostic thing when there is a irreversibility of malignant spinal cord compression and when there is a sacral nerve infiltration. And we know that when there is a huge pelvic tumor or any obstruction happening in the anorectal region, any bowel obstruction can cause constipation. All these scenarios, in all the symptoms, we discuss a lot of causes. But I think in my experience, when you deal with constipation, you see all of this very regularly. All these issues come across in a very, very routine manner. At least every day we see some of these reasons, patients coming with constipation from one of these reasons. Depression, last week we discussed about a patient who had constipation and who had all the other features, probably a pathological depression. So very commonly associated with depression also. diets, we know that our patients can't drink too much, even if we insist, have a good fiber diet, take plenty of fluids, not possible for them. They're already having a lot of weakness, anorexia, cachexia, nausea, vomiting. So very important, very difficult for them to follow the diet pattern. And comorbidities like diabetes. And many of them would be bedbound, inactivity will be there. And that is another reason for having constipation. Even without any advanced cancer or anything, elderly patients, when they become immobile and inactive, they can have constipation very, very commonly. And inability to obey call. That is a very relevant thing. That looks like a very simple thing, but many times patients are bedridden and then have to call their wife or children who might have just gone from them to the kitchen to do something. And then they have to call them to go to the toilet. They just don't want to bother others. So they think, okay, let's wait for them to finish. And then the call is gone. The inability to obey the call. When they want to go, they can't go. So that dependence and the feeling of depending on others is another reason for constipation. Many of the patients, the moment you prescribe laxatives, they don't want to take because they don't want to bother others, especially when they are bedridden. Or the caregivers would say, No, laxatives don't give because it's very difficult if he passes every now and then there is no one at home during daytime, etc. So inability to obey call is one of the important thing I would say. What are the common causes in our patient population? Of course, drugs like opioids, dehydration, the same reasons itself, reduced mobility. Most of them would be bedridden or just sitting in the bed most of the time. Hypercalcemia along with nausea, vomiting and pain, the third symptom would be constipation. Neurological deficits and drugs like ondansetron, anticholinergics, and many of the antacids will have aluminium salts. So the antacids with aluminium salts can cause constipation. So how does morphine cause constipation? You might have heard about this in your session, but just to revise, it decreases the propulsive intestinal activity and it increases the non-propulsive activity. So sum up, no propulsion. No action in the GIT. And when there is no action, there is additional time for more and more water reabsorption. So one thing, gut is not moving. Second thing, more water reabsorption. So the stools will become really hard. So hard stools stuck somewhere. That is a basic thing happening when you give morphine. And again, they inhibit the secretomotor neurons. So there is less fluid entering the gut. There is not much of secretion happening and more water is being taken up also. And about, last one would be reduces the sensation of rectal distension. So what happens, they don't feel that the urge to pass the stool. So there will be fecal impaction. There will be loaded rectum very often, you see. And it should be a routine. I know that most of you would be practicing that already, but those who are not doing that, please start from tomorrow onwards. The moment you ask the patient, when you go for the rounds or when you go for home visit, ask about constipation voluntarily and don't stop there. Just ask all these questions. When was, they may say no constipation, no issue with the bowel. So then ask, when did the patient's bowel last move? Oh, that was 2 to 3 days back. Yesterday, or they may say, today morning I had a bowel opening. Okay, that is good. What is the consistency, size and volume? Then they may say it was hard, lumpy, a little bit. Anyway, I'm not eating. I'm just drinking some fluids every now and then. So it was, I had a bowel opening, but it was hard, lumpy stool. Was there any blood or mucus in the stool? What was the color of the stool? Black, red, greenish, whatever. How easily?
I don't have to take care of. I will just take care of monkey.
How easy? Ease of passage. Did you have to strain a lot or was it okay? You had a good bowel opening without straining much. And ask for sensation of incomplete emptying. I had bowel opening, but I feel that it is incomplete. I still have something inside to go. So ask for tenesmus. Fecal incontinence. Do you have frequent soiling of clothes? When they tell you loose stools, two things you have to ask. Is it large quantity of stool or is it just like leaking of stools, frequent soiling of clothes? And the moment they say loose stools, ask when they had the last bowel opening. Very, very commonly they may say 1 week back. So what happens? That is an overflow diarrhea. The fecal matter is impacted and all the bacterial products and the fluids will seep out from the sides, but the heart stool will be remaining inside the GIT. So very high up, not anywhere near the rectum. So ask, the moment you hear diarrhea or loose stools, ask them when was the last bowel opening and how much quantity, how did it look like? Is it like leaking? This is one of the commonest used tool in many of the countries, and I find it very, very useful to ask the patient what kind of fecal matter they had, because it's very difficult to explain in local language, and people find it really embarrassing to talk about in detail. So ask, just show this picture in your phone or whatever device you carry, and if you have any confusion whether they are constipated, just ask them what kind of stools they had every morning. Very commonly you will say type 1. They might have had good bowel opening, but separate hard lumps, like small lumps, like fecal matter. Suspicious, you have to be really suspicious all the time in palliative care, only for constipation. Never ever believe the patient when they say about constipation. It is the other way around in pain. I just don't trust any patient when they say they are not having constipation. Very commonly they will be constipated and you have to probe again and again and again. Don't trust the patient, because they very commonly relate to the dietary intake or one hard lump has passed today morning. That is fine. That is not fine. They will end up in a lot of issue later. I still remember very early in my career, maybe 2-3 years when I was into palliative care, a lady came to us. The cancer was nowhere in the GIT, but she had a bowel obstruction, all the signs of bowel obstruction, and we have given all the management. She could not recover, and then we sent her to a very senior gastroenterologist and took opinion. So many back and forth happens. The whole tract was loaded with fecal matter. Nothing else. Nothing could be done. He could not. Gastro surgeon cannot operate and take out the fecal matter, right? So nothing could be done, and she died out of bowel obstruction just because of fecal matter, no other lesion. So that was very eye-opening for every one of us. From that day onwards, we make sure that patients will be asked about constipation every single day you see them. Ask again, probe a lot, and every third day minimum, at least every third day, there should be some bowel opening. So that is very mandatory in all the settings in our IPOP or home care. Do the physical examination of abdomen and listen for bowel sounds. And if you're really confused, ask permission, make them come and do a pelvic examination. That is the only way to pick things up. It's not a pleasant thing, but still sometimes we do have to do a rectal examination if you are not convinced about what they are talking. So in this symptom for constipation, don't trust the patient and never trust the caregiver, because caregiver don't have any idea. The patient might be going to the toilet every now and then and coming back without any bowel opening. But the caregiver would be seeing, oh, he is going 4-5 times a day. No issue with the bowel. So don't trust the caregiver at all when it comes to constipation. Rectal examination, not at all a pleasant thing. No one wants to get this. Even none of us would want to get this. But if we have to find out whether what the patient is talking about is constipation or actual diarrhea, or is it a loaded rectum feeling, or is it a mass, then you have to have a rectal examination. And everyone knows, I know that there will be a lot of people who can talk about it much authoritatively than me, but this is what we follow. If the rectum is empty and collapses, we know that it is a functioning bowel. Just check what you feel around your finger. If it is empty and collapsing around your fingers, then you know that it is a functional bowel. And if the rectum is empty and dilated, we know that the fecal matter is somewhere high up in the bowel. Check for the balloony rectum. Check for the moment you take the finger out, look at the fingertip. Whether it is fecal matter, whether it is blood, or what kind of fecal matter you have in the fingertip, always look for that. And when you do a particular examination, check for the surface, whether it is irregular, just to see whether it is you are touching a tumor or a fecal matter. And if there is a loaded rectum with fecal matter in the rectum, check for the consistency, whether it is pasty or hard. So then only we can decide whether they need an enema or just a suppository would be enough. So check for balloony rectum always. When you have a lot of space around your finger, then you have to think about the overflow diarrhea or fecal matter stuck somewhere high in the bowel. Prevention is the medicine. And the moment you write morphine, you should write a laxative. The hand that charts morphine should chart the laxative. You might have read in Robert Wycross's book. This is one thing he has mentioned very particularly about prescribing morphine. The moment you write morphine, the next prescription should be of a laxative. And tell the patient that you are writing a constipating drug, you have to take laxative. Because you write laxative and you send the laxative with them, they reach back home, oh, okay, I don't have a constipation, so why should I take the laxative? They keep them away. So you have to tell them, we are starting on morphine, morphine is a very constipating drug, so you have to have laxatives. I tell one extra sentence that you will not have loose stools. Don't worry about that. This is a medicine that can just push your normal fecal matter out. So you will not have a loose stools. Management, we have to talk about non-pharmacological management first. Tell them to assess daily ourselves whether we have a good bowel opening or not. Just tell the patient to notice themselves. And if at all possible, do some movement over the bed. Most of the time, it is not feasible in our setting, but if possible, we can tell about that. Access to toilet facility, I would emphasize the most in this non-pharmacological measures. You give laxatives, you have given everything. Then the patient will have to walk to some ground nearby in the other end of the place to have a toilet facility. Not possible, right? Or they are wheelchair bound and the toilet is not wheelchair friendly. Or it is an Indian type closet, they can't sit there and have. So access to toilet facility is really important. A commode chair costs very, very less. Very often our patients, most of the problems are solved by giving a commode chair. A plastic commode chair, hardly nothing it costs. So they can have a privacy. They can keep it in their own room and everything. They don't have to walk. So access is very, very well taken care of with that. And prompt response to patients called. Very often we know that the caregivers would just have gone to have a bath, or they might have just gone to the other side of the kitchen to take care of something. Then the patient wants to have a bowel opening. So inside the room, if you can provide something which they can use on their own, that is better. In wards, when you do a parenteral examination or give an enema or whatever, or the routine bowel opening, ensure privacy. Just keep a screen around the bed. Many of the places, if that will not happen. So I would not want to have a bowel opening in an open area where the other patients are lying down. So I prefer to be constipated than having a bowel opening. So we have to ensure privacy and ask for other symptoms like pain or nausea and vomiting. So we have a classification of laxatives, not as confusing as antiemetics, very simple, because we have only one or two that can be given to our patients. So we don't need to think about others. Bulk forming, softeners, osmotic, stimulant. So bulk forming laxatives is very commonly used by gastro people, but in palliative care, it cannot be usually used because it increases the fecal mass. And you give morphine, some drug which is not even moving the GIT, and there is a huge fecal mass. So what happens? It is you are actually aggravating all the symptoms. So bulk forming laxative is not indicated in palliative care patients because they need to drink extra water also, which is not feasible. And what is our problem? Our problem is GIT not moving and stools are really hard. So bulk forming laxative cannot be used. Osmotic laxatives like lactulose is one of the most commonly used laxative, like ondansetron we talked about last week. The most common prescription for as an antiemetic. And I must say that the most common prescription for constipation would be lactulose. Everywhere you go, patient will have a bottle of lactulose at their home. But very often that may not be the solution. That may not be the answer for their constipation. It has an osmotic effect. So very rarely it can cause dehydration. It is very good when you don't want the bacterial colonization there, especially when you have a hepatic encephalopathy and a constipation, then this would be one drug that I would use. This is another, the other class would be softness. So we heard about bulk forming laxative. We heard about osmotic laxative like lactulose. And the third class would be fecal softness. Just very simple, soften the fecal matter. But you cannot use it alone as a laxative. There is no point in softening the fecal matter. We need something to soften as well as to move. So we need to combine a stimulant also. So stimulant laxative, the example, the very commonly used drug is bisacodine. It has direct action on myenteric plexus and submucosal plexus. So it acts as a kind of irritant. It stimulates the GIT and it should be avoided in complete obstruction. Very rarely patients will tell you, I have colicky abdominal pain I have when I take bisacodine. Then you have to look for other measures. This is a usual prescription. We start with 10 milligram bedtime because it takes time to act. So when you give bedtime morning, next day morning, usually they will have a good bowel opening. In the beginning, you may or may not add the softener. I usually ask the problem exactly. Is the problem due to difficulty in straining or is the problem due to hard fecal matter? So if it is difficulty, very much straining, then I would give only the stimulant. If they say hard lumpy stools, then I'll give a combination of stimulant and a softener. That is a preferred combination. So start with 10 milligram HS, add a softener if needed, then gradually increase if he is still constipated into 5, 5, 10, and then 10, 10, 10. 30 milligram would be the maximum dose that can be given. And we can give other measures, rectal measures like manual removal if needed. Very often needed, I must say, suppositories and low or high enema. So I have mentioned high enema and I don't have a slide on how it is to be given. I think next time I'll include that picture also. So when you do the rectal examination and you feel that the rectum is balloony and the fecal matter is impacted high up in the bowel, then you have to give a high up enema because you know that fecal matter is high. You have to reach there, not in the periphery and give an enema and just go and aram. So you can't sit. The bowel will not open. So you have to take a suction catheter, very small one, or a red rubber catheter, or even a Foley's catheter, whatever it is available in your setting. Usually we use suction catheter because it is very thin. Nicely coat with lignocaine, smear with lignocaine and gently insert that suction catheter as much as possible without any resistance. So once you pass it, usually it goes full without any resistance. And then you attach your enema sachet to the other end of the suction catheter and administer enema. So what happens, you literally go near or above the loaded fecal matter. And then there you are giving enema. So usually it will work. So make sure when you do a parenteral examination, if the bowel is balloony or logically, if the patient is having more than 5 days, 6 days, 7 days constipation, there is no point in giving a low enema. You have to give a high enema. Spurious diarrhea, very, very confusing thing. Patient will come to you, tell that I have a loose stool. So as I said, okay, loose stool, how many days? 2 to 3 days. When was your last bowel opening? Usually it will be a week or 10 days or 20 days, 30 days back. So this is very much suggestive of chronic constipation and fecal impaction. So differentiate between diarrhea and overflow diarrhea. If don't trust the patient, if you are confused, do a rectal examination and do a digital evacuation if possible, and then regularize the laxative. So it is not a symptom. It's not a disease per se, but it's a very, very overlooked symptom, very underreported symptom. No laxatives would work if you don't prescribe at all or if the patient don't take at all. Sometimes we prescribe, they don't take because they're scared whether I have a loose stool episode. All the laxatives work, but you have to think whether it is palatable for the patient. Sometimes the syrup may not taste good, so they don't want to take this particular preparation. And you know that Crimafin itself has plenty of combination. So try one thing or the other. Some of them have even a stimulant in that. So just make sure what you are giving before you prescribe. The usual recommended combination generally is a softener and a stimulant. So I know that I slightly rushed because we have to take another presentation on bowel obstruction. And after the bowel obstruction, we will discuss both the topics together. So that was about constipation, very, very commonly encountered symptom. And the next one would be bowel obstruction. And there are plenty of scenarios for bowel obstruction, but today we'll be mostly focusing on cancer and anti-cancer treatment related and with the radiographic evidence and problem in transiting of GI contents. So usually cancer and anti-cancer related treatment, we know that there are plenty of other reasons by which bowel obstruction can happen. It has a different management approach depending on the signs and symptoms. And we know that the bowel obstruction is not really a good thing. Patient coming to you with bowel obstruction, we should ring the bell, okay, mostly seen in advanced stages of cancer, and median survival would be anywhere very short months. They say in the books, it is 1 to 3 months. And obstruction means it can occur anywhere from esophagus to rectum, very commonly seen in small bowel and very commonly associated with gynecological cancer followed by cancer colon. We always think that it is colon cancer that can, but it is usually seen, very commonly seen with gynecological cancers and then with the colon cancer. So what are the types of obstruction? There are many types, single site, multiple site. It can be partial or complete. It can be extrinsic or intrinsic, functional or mechanical. Sometimes the obstruction is from the outside the GIT, compressing the GIT from outside, or it can be from the lumen, intraluminar, or can be from the intestinal muscles itself, intramural type of obstruction. So many of the obstruction can be from treatment, post-surgical adhesions. Some of the chemotherapeutic agents after the chemotherapy can cause desmoplastic reactions. Torsions, I have not seen much, but that can be a reason for bowel obstruction, and very commonly internal hernia also. And not easy to differentiate all these, like whether it is due to desmoplastic reaction or internal hernia. It's not that easy, especially in a palliative care setting. Maybe easier in an oncology setting because we have a lot of investigations going on. Very rarely we do see pseudo obstruction. So what happens in pseudo obstruction? There can be destruction of enteric neurons. So there can be pseudo obstruction. It mimics like obstruction, but it is not really a compression or an obstruction per se. Some of the drugs can cause severe ileus, and very rarely in diabetic neuropathy, patients come to you with all the signs and symptoms of obstruction. So we will go on to pathophysiology of bowel obstruction. What happens in bowel obstruction is that we know that there is a block, an occlusion in the lumen. So there is a delay in propulsion. So imagine a tube, there is a block. There is delay in propulsion. The contents are not moving distally. So intestine, poor thing, will try hard to overcome the obstruction. It will give more and more peristalsis thinking that, okay, I'm going to overcome this obstruction. But what happens? Sometimes it may win, sometimes it may fail. This phase is actually reversible. It is a sub-obstructive phase because the intestine itself will try to overcome the obstruction by giving more and more colicky peristalsis. So although if there is no movement also, the bowel continues to contract. So what happens? That the movement becomes then uncoordinated, all becomes haphazard and haywire. There is uncoordinated peristaltic activity causing more and more colicky pain episodes. So as a consequence, the bowel is trying to move the contents distally, but it is not moving. Everything is getting accumulated. So bowel becomes distended because there is a block. Nothing is moving distally. It becomes distended. The moment it is distended, it causes more and more fluid secretion as a reaction. So it becomes like a cycle. More distension, more secretion. Again, that causes more and more obstruction. Distension, more secretion. So it becomes like a cycle. The contents will remain there itself. And we know that when there is more obstruction, if the GI tract is not moving the contents distally, there is accumulation of bacteria. Things are getting bad. Bacteria is coming there. If they produce more gases. So what happens? The more gases means more distension in the bowel again. And so you know that the things are getting more and more, it's becoming worse. And when there is bacteria, we know that there is inflammation. The moment inflammation word comes, you know that Cox pathway is coming into action and there is hyperemia of vessels. So what happens is the bowel wall becomes edematous. Again, that is causing more obstruction because the bowel wall itself has caused edematous. So there is a reduction in the venous drainage from the obstructed segment causing hypoxia. So there is hypoxia in the other segments because there is a congestion, there is a block in the venous drainage. And this will cause increase in vasoactive intestinal polypeptides. This will cause redistribution of blood flow. So there is a whole lot of change in the blood flow in the obstructed part and the unobstructed part. This can lead to multi-organ failure and hypotension at the later stage. And what happens as a consequence, you will have hypovolemia because there is decreased renal flow and it can cause renal failure. Again, there are a lot of metabolic issues that can happen. Like I've mentioned, alkalosis, hypochloremia, etc., etc. So a lot of metabolic disorders depending on the site of obstruction. And when there is more obstruction, what happens? The diaphragm will be elevated, which will cause decreased pulmonary ventilation. So patient will come to you with a lot of breathlessness. I can't breathe. I can lie down. And all the signs of decreased pulmonary ventilation. And you know that the bacteria is still there in the gut because everything is obstructed. All these toxins will pass to the systemic circulation and the lymphatics, which will cause sepsis at the later stage. So this is the sequence how it progresses. Rule of thumb. This is one thing which we need to remember when you are planning to manage bowel obstruction. Higher the obstruction, the symptoms will be more and the signs will be less. So higher the obstruction, the patient will come to you really quickly. If with the lower obstruction, patients will not have much symptoms. So they will wait and come at a very, very later stage. All the signs and symptoms are dependent on the site of obstruction. I use the example of a blocked wash basin. If the wash basin is blocked at the outlet itself, the moment you wash hands, you know that the water will not go down. Everything will get accumulated then and there. Early signs and symptoms, early and severe nausea and vomiting because the wash basin is blocked at the outlet. So you know that the morning itself, the moment you start washing your hands, the water get blocked. You know that there is some problem in the wash basin. I have to remove the block. But what happens if the block is very well, very far down, somewhere near the outside or somewhere? What happens? You can still wash your hands and use the wash basin, maybe till evening without any problem. And by evening, all the fluid will get accumulated and everything will come out slowly, slowly, slowly. The fluid will come out and then only you will realize there was a block. So in gastric outlet obstruction, the patient will come to you with sudden onset of nausea and vomiting. But in small bowel obstruction, there will be more cramping with nausea and vomiting at a later stage. These are the symptoms. First thing would be pain. There can be two types of pain. One thing they would say, there is a continuous background pain. There is a continuous background pain and there is an intermittent crampiform pain. The moment I think about eating food or drink something, I have a crampiform pain. So there is always a pain in my tummy, but it increases when I think about food, usually or even otherwise. So that is one symptom, pain. The second would be nausea and vomiting. So how will we differentiate large bowel and small bowel obstruction when it comes to vomiting? You know, if the block is very far down, usually it comes as a feculent because in the wash basin, you have washed everything from the morning. All the dirty waters has been accumulating and then it is coming out. So usually it will be foul smelling. The same thing with the gut. The patient will tell you, I could eat breakfast, I could have lunch a little bit, but when the moment I took dinner, then I started vomiting. Usually they will say. So morning, everything was going down because the obstruction is very far down. And at night, slowly they will have vomiting. And what happens in small bowel vomiting or gastric outlet obstruction, bilious and large quantity vomiting. Usually it will not be foul smelling. they will say I vomited immediately after taking food. The moment I take food, the same thing. If I drink tea, the tea is coming out. Constipation, flatus and stool are absent in complete obstruction. Very, very important question. Are you passing flatus? Not just don't stop with the stool because in complete obstruction, they can't pass flatus also. Very, very important question in differentiating complete or incomplete obstruction. Check for bowel sounds. There will be altered bowel sounds. So this table has summarized all the signs and symptoms in proximal and distal obstruction. So again, I always use, for myself, I use the example of wash basin. So it's easy for me to relate things when the patient is telling you. There can be a continuous pain and a colicky pain. Usually in proximal obstruction, they may say, they can point out very clearly, I have pain around the umbilicus. I have short intermittent cramps. But in distal obstruction, the symptoms will be really late. And it will be deep visceral pain very commonly. And they may say long intervals between the cramps. Vomiting, large amount of vomiting in the proximal obstruction. And usually watery or bilious. No foul odor. But in distal obstruction, everything is getting accumulated. So the amount will be like slight leaking of vomitus. And it usually will have very foul smell. Distension is usually absent in outlet obstruction, but it is usually seen in distal obstruction. Constipation may or may not be present in gastric outlet obstruction, but in the other case, usually there will be long-standing days to weeks constipation in complete obstruction, in a distal obstruction. It rarely comes as an emergency. Whatever management plan that you are thinking or devising for the patient, the important thing here is to understand the overall status, understand where in the illness trajectory they are. So according to that, we have to set the goals of care. Sometimes the first presentation, if there are oncologists in this group, the first presentation itself would be a bowel obstruction, and then you go back and diagnose there was a cancer. But then your goals of care is entirely different, right? So the moment the patient present with bowel obstruction, we know that it is an advanced thing usually. It's not a good prognostic factor. And understand where in the illness trajectory the patients are, and then set goals of care and discuss the plan of care. Address all the symptoms like pain, nausea, irrespective of what your plan is. You have to address pain, nausea, vomiting, and constipation. And necessary investigations to be done, like a check for electrolytes and hydrate the patient if needed. The one easily doable and accessible to most of the palliative care settings would be abdominal radiographs. Maybe in a cancer hospital, you can look for higher investigations because the oncologist would anyway will be doing a lot of investigations to understand the site and size and everything of the tumor. But if you are in a standalone unit and then you don't have access to many of the investigations, I would say this is one of the best things that you can do, abdominal radiographs, if you're suspecting constipation, the bowel obstruction. You can see multiple air fluid levels. Plain x-ray, erect abdomen. Usually in the outlet obstruction, there is no definitive value for x-rays. But in distal obstruction, you can see dilated bowel loops or multiple air fluid levels. It is very effective in ruling out constipation, which will present as bowel obstruction. And this is a supine. Usually we recommend erect abdomen, not the supine x-ray. This is the most useful test. We know that the CT, 100% useful, it says, but many of the settings won't have access to CT. But and we have never ever had to depend on a CT scan to understand the extent of obstruction. But yeah, it depends on where in the illness trajectory the patient was in. The patient is first time presenting with obstruction, and then you need to understand what exactly is happening, where, the size, the peritumor area, then CT would be the investigation. It can locate the obstruction, differentiates between the types, and then it helps in taking decision whether you should go for surgery or just palliation is needed. then you can see the area around the obstruction, whether there is any adhesions or a mass around the obstructed area. So coming to the management again, you have to think where exactly in the illness trajectory is this patient. Is the patient is in advanced cancer stage and very few weeks to months to live, then you have to think what kind of management that you want to give, whether it is referring to a surgeon or just a palliation would be the best treatment to be given. So whatever said and done, whatever type of decision you are taking, frequent mouth care and frequent sipping of water, keeping the patient hydrated is really important. And choose a route of administration depending on the site of obstruction. So we saw a few symptoms, pain. We saw nausea, vomiting, and constipation and feeling of distension. Four symptoms the patients come with usually. So how do you manage pain? Opioids are the drug of choice depending on the type of pain and the score and severity of the pain. Usually opioids would be needed in obstruction, and you have to think about the route of opioid, because very often the patient will have nausea and vomiting. And if the obstruction is at the outlet area itself, then we don't know whether it is going to get absorbed or not. So we have to think wisely about the route of administration. The other very important drug in managing bowel obstruction would be steroid. Not just any steroid, it is dexamethasone. 8 to 16 milligram is the dose that we use. We use it as a 3-day trial and then assess whether it has done some benefit for the patient after 3 days. So the action, we know that it reduces the bowel wall edema. So we are trying to manage the block by reducing a little bit of edema. So we have made a small space. We assume that we are going to make a small space through which the contents can pass. So we given steroid, we assume that a bowel wall edema or the peritumor edema has come down a little bit. We know that the edema is there both in the bowel wall and in the peritumor area. So if you give steroid, then we know that a little bit of space would have been made. And then you give a prokinetic to push the contents through the new space that you created. So the drug of choice would be metoclopramide, starting with 30 milligram to 120 milligram per day. Either you give intermittent dose or give as a continuous subcutaneous infusion. Ask for any colicky pain, because in case the patient is having complete bowel obstruction or you did not get any space even after giving steroid, then if you give a prokinetic, we know that the colicky pain would increase and there is chance of perforation. So it should be initiated if you can monitor the patient. Even in home care setting, we give, but we call and ask the patient, do you have any pain after giving this particular injection? For complete obstruction, or you have given opioid to reduce pain, and then you have given steroid so that the edema is reduced, and a prokinetic not resolving. So then you have to be suspicious about a complete obstruction. If the obstruction is complete, you cannot give prokinetic. Then your goal of care is completely shifting to total symptom management. We can say gut paralysis. You just give something to slow down the gut, less secretion, less movement. And we have to focus more on symptom management rather than trying to bypass the block. So bypassing is done by steroid and the prokinetic. Not working, then accept that it can be a complete obstruction. If it is a complete obstruction, then the drugs would be hyoscine butyl bromide, that is the buscopan, anywhere from 40 to 240 per day subcutaneous. Usually we need continuous infusion, not intermittent doses. Ranitidine infusions have been proven to have a lot of anti-secretory effects. So the fluid buildup is literally reduced when you give a continuous infusion of ranitidine, 200 milligram per day. So another very commonly used drug is a somatostatin analog, which is octreotide, very commonly used in many oncology settings. So the action is, I think it's like a cocktail. It reduces secretion, it reduces the motility, it reduces the bile flow. It helps in changing the spankling circulation, shifting. So then the volume is reduced. The vomiting volume is also reduced. So it's mainly indicated for high volume vomiters. But you know that it's a very kind of expensive drug, and there are many solid studies comparing octreotide and placebo, and found that it is not as glorious as we think, especially octreotide. We think that octreotide is a great drug. Sometimes it do work, but not more than a combination of steroid and a prokinetic. Usually it is given, or it should be given ideally as a continuous subcutaneous infusion, not as intermittent dose. It acts better when you give a subcutaneous infusion. You can go up to 800 microgram per day. I have used it once in a much higher dose, about 1200 microgram per day, or continuous subcutaneous infusion, because there was high volume of outlet through the colostomy bag, and the colostomy bag was getting filled in every 10 minutes. So, but it was very well managed with octreotide because it was a high volume kind of outflow. Nausea and vomiting, we have dealt with the nausea and vomiting last class. But so initially you gave the prokinetic, but if you know that the obstruction is complete, you cannot give the prokinetic. Stop the metoclopramide and then switch to haloperidol or promethazine. I have not used promethazine per se in this kind of setting. Usually it settles with haloperidol, or we have discussed about olanzapine. So all these drugs. Constipation, in a complete obstruction, you can't expect a bowel opening because you have already paralyzed the gut. The gut is not moving, so you can't expect a bowel opening. But gentle rectal measures, and we can try with a small dose of softener and check whether the patient is having a colic or not. And if any irritation, don't give the laxative. Surgical options. These are the surgical options, but in the end, you can read that the primary intention of surgeries should be improving the quality of life and symptom management, not for the disease modifying or the curative side. Usually the obstruction surgeries are palliative surgeries. Surgery needed complete resection. If it is a single site obstruction, resectable tumor, then surgery would be an option. Or sometimes to create a stoma, divert everything so that the patient is not symptomatically much, much better. So that surgery can do a lot in terms of improving the quality of life, but at some stage of illness, not at all stages. That is why from the beginning I was telling, you have to understand at what stage of illness trajectory the patient is in. Then only recommend them for surgery or any other intervention. Otherwise, you can manage very well with the drugs that I have been mentioning. Interventional management, I have purposefully included NG tube insertion. NG tube insertion is an invasive and an intervention. It is not something just putting a tube, it is an intervention. So NG tube insertion, it should be a temporary measure, very temporary measure to drain out all the secretions if the patient is having a very high discomfort. Useful in proximal obstruction, not in distal obstruction. So your idea should be to vent gastrointestinal secretion and to relieve the feeling of distension. And the moment you are done with that, just remove the NG tube as much as possible. And we had a patient who wanted to eat and drink whatever he wants, and he had an NG tube in place which was connected to a uro bag. So all the secretions will get collected in the uro bag. And he used to eat. And then he knows that the bowel is getting, his obstruction was of course proximal obstruction and outlet obstruction. So he eats whatever he wants. Then he feels distended. Then he aspirates through the NG tube, and the distension or the discomfort is relieved. So he knew what was happening, and he knew that he was going to die. He was in an advanced stage of illness, but he wanted to eat. So when he eats, he will have feeling of distension, then he will drain the secretion. So you can educate very well about this kind of management also. Interventional management, one thing would be venting gastrostomy. If you have access to a good gastrosurgeon who knows that this patient is going to have an advanced, advanced stages, but to increase or to improve the quality of life. If the performance scale is okay, then you can actually, only if it is feasible. Don't give hope that if if ever we could have done a venting gastrostomy, then they would run for a venting gastrostomy. So don't recommend if it is not feasible at all for the patient. Stents usually have high failure rate. So it can be a last option, usually not recommended, only if it is a single site obstruction and to reduce or relieve the secretion, then you can think about it. High rates of failure. TN, very commonly, I have mentioned this because in most of the hospital settings, it's very commonly seen picture the patient with bowel obstruction, NPO with a bag of TPN hanging. And the family's full hope will be on the TPN, thinking that this TPN is very expensive, looks very, very nutritious because it is white colored, huge bag. So they think that you are giving something which can make the patient immortal. No, and they'll run out of money. So it is indicated only if there is a minimal tumor burden and he is going for a definitive surgery and a very good performance scale. Then you can think of TPN for some time and you are expecting a good life expectancy. Going to have a definitive surgery very soon, then TPN might be an option, but not for advanced illness and the patients who are actually nearing end of life. So this is a summary. And again, I have stressed the fact that you have to understand at which stage of illness trajectory they are in, and goals should depend on how aggressively you should go to address these symptoms. You should, whatever way you choose, you have to address the symptoms like pain, nausea, vomiting, constipation. Use the medications either parenterally, sublingually, or rectally, or transdermally, whichever way is feasible in your setting. And even without any surgical reference or any intervention or any of those the invasive things, you can always make the patients and family really, really comfortable with the medications and explain them why you are using steroid in the language that they understand. So today I'm going to put a medication for 3 days and see whether we can bypass some of the block. If it is working, then you would have a few more days of non-obstruction, but again, the obstruction can come back. So talk to the patient about every medication that you use. And then gradually take them to the place where you are. So I have stopped my presentation. I know that I rushed a little bit because there were two topics, but I think I've covered all the important areas, and you will be getting those PPTs, and if you want, you can go through that.
Okay, thank you. So you can ask your doubts. You can take some time.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Dr. Sridevi, thank you for the beautiful presentation. I just wanted to know, you said trial of steroids and prokinetics whenever there is a proximal obstruction for 3 days. Then supposing the patient responds, how long can we continue the steroids and prokinetics?
We usually taper down. Patient responding means that patient has less pain now, less vomiting. Mm-hmm. Right. So the symptoms have improved. So mm-hmm. we start with anywhere at 8 to 16 milligram. We give it for 3 days. So for example, I must say I have given 16 milligram for the 3 days. Then I would gradually taper it down 8 milligram. Mm-hmm. And I'll keep it. I'll try to stop it if possible. Or mm-hmm. sometimes patients would say when I reduce from 4 to 2, then they develop symptoms. Then I know that the lowest possible dose would be 4 milligram. Right. So I try to reduce and stop it completely. And then I gradually I try to stop the prokinetic also. It's a very common thing. Usually patients will get rid of both these drugs mm-hmm. after tapering down and stopping. Then they have a period of non-obstruction for quite a few, sometimes a few days to weeks. Again, of course, they will come back again with an episode of obstruction. But either you can stop by tapering down or keep it as a minimum dose of steroid as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. And if not responding at all, just stop there. Steroid is not working. There is no no point in there is no need of tapering also, because you have given only 1 or 2 days. You can stop it.
So in the standard system, if something which we have usually managed with liver or then IV fluids, antibiotics, and we don't know what happens to this patient in advanced disease. Probably the patient may not have. It will not be possible for the patient to undergo any intervention, and those patients might be discharged. And when we were working in a corporate hospital, so we were one of the famous hospitals in Kerala. Now we had a GA surgery department, and they were telling us that we are doing surgery, but we don't know what is happening to those patients, and you might be. So that's what they told us. You have. The prognosis of the patient before you refer the patient for any intervention. In case of a patient with. In the stand of section in advanced management. Anybody else?
Dr. Sunil, can we move on to our case?
If there are no more questions, I think we will move on to patient story. So we can be presented by Dr. Nina. So Dr. Nina, it's over to you.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yes, doctor, we can hear you. You can start.
Yeah. Good evening. Dr. Sridevi, it was a wonderful presentation and really enjoyed your talk, the previous one as well, today's. So today I am presenting a case presentation. It's a simple case. The case history is one of the patient in my OPD, she was a little emotional and she was talking about that my husband gets angry at me and he's not listening to me and he's not doing well. So it started with that. I inquired and I came to know that her husband is not doing really well. And so it is the case of the husband. He's a 42-year-old male worker in an industry, occasional alcoholic, non-smoker, and he had complaints of difficulty in walking. He had backache. The pain was radiating to lower limbs. Initially, the pain started more on the left hip and then it was more on the back. Then there was no incontinence of urine or bowel seen. He was non-hypertensive, non-diabetic patient. But this story goes back in September 2020, where the physical activity literally reduced to bed. And he was lying all the time in the bed. Some investigations were done. He was admitted in a hospital and the investigations were of early lumbar spondylosis and left hip joint effusion, non-infective origin. And they had found that vitamin D3 levels were low. Rheumatoid arthritis, uric acid, that was normal. X-ray left hip showed deformity and flattened with sclerosis. Then general examination was non-specific. He was a healthy male, but sleeping most of the time due to these problems and having fights with his wife. So when I started talking to him earlier, in October 2020, he never used to talk or even look at me. He never liked the idea of me visiting his home and talking to him or to his wife. And so the journey started from there, and he was not taking bath. There was very poor hygiene, and he had some infection of skin, which was treated by me. And then when he got cured of that skin disease, I think he had some faith in me and he started talking to me. Then he was treated with muscle relaxants, D3 supplements, B complexes and multivitamins and antibiotics with a local application. I did not realize much about his pain that time. But when I started doing this course of palliative medicine, I understand now that what all history I should be taking. So again, I revisited him when I started this course. And now I have found that the pain more is of a radiating type of pain. And the lumbar spondylosis is still there. He has got a very minimal physical activity of just walking one or two steps. And he has stopped all allopathic medicines. And he was taking some medicine from a quack, some powdered form he was taking. And initially, he was very irritable and anxious. So I understand that his social pain now, because why he had fights with his wife or why he was anxious, because he was feeling isolated. There was financial problem. And so I did the counseling to him, had 2-3 home visits, and advised him that we will do further treatment for his hip. Second thing which I did was that I identified that the main problem was the finances problem. So I identified that his son was around 20 years old, and I could manage a job for his son. And I think after that, he started having faith in me. He started listening to me. So then started his treatment on tramadol with paracetamol combination and laxatives. And he was symptomatically improving. But the problem of vascular necrosis of the left hip joint is still there. And there has been the whole, it has flattened the head. And there is erosion also. And we will be doing a further evaluation for him. But what I understood with the palliative course was that initially I never used to, sit and talk to him about his problem. I used to try and understand his problem from his wife. So this I stopped. I started talking to him. I started talking to him about his pain. Like, what do you think about this pain? What do you think? How much severe is this pain? Or how will you grade this pain? And where it is exactly paining? And all these things I started discussing with him. And that, I think that I also learned many things with him. And he also started feeling good about it. Then he started talking, smiling at me whenever I go to him. And somehow a 42-year-old male, you know, getting himself, confined to bed and not, you know, willing to get treated or not willing to start earning for his family or whatever. I mean, that was very hurting for me. So then I started motivating him that you start, why you are losing this hope? You should not be losing this hope. And I think there, this may not be really a success story as such, but at least I have made changes in him is that he no longer complains about pain. Whenever I'm there, he will talk something about his son. He is interested in his surroundings. And he is now interested. Today, I was very happy when he talked about getting himself treated. He may be needing a bone graft and he's ready to go there. And I will be helping him out in that. And then I told him that we will need to do physiotherapy for him. And he may not have the normal strength or normal walk, but he will be able to do his daily activities on his own. And he was very happy about it. So I understood that though the pain, physical pain is important, but we need to even concentrate on the emotional pain and the social pain. And I asked him, what do you like? Like you listen, he said, I like to listen to songs. So I said, okay, now you start listening to songs. So things like that, I talked to him about his what is he going to do in his spare time. So he said, I have got some spiritual books and I want to read that to other people. So I said, it's a good idea. You call some elders in the village, 2-3 at a time, and you will have a good company. So he was, you know, happy about it. So I think this the lessons I learned from this is that we used to always treat only physical symptoms because we never visit homes. So we never understand what is happening at the home background or what is their pain inside or what are their requirements, what social support they want. And I think this course has opened my eyes where I understand that he needs a company. He needs to have people talking to him. He needs people to understand him. And at the same time, we need to motivate him for more treatment and good treatment after this. So at this stage, I would like to say that we have planned the treatment for him and we are very helpful about it that we'll be doing a bone grafting. I'll see if I can get it sponsored from somewhere or let me see how to get it done. But we will have discussion with the orthopedic doctor and it will be always with his son and wife. And also, I have asked him focus on his spiritual aspect to get strength from there. And he has started contacting his old friends now. I suggested him that you talk to them frequently. And he was very happily telling me that. And I think acceptance of problem, acceptance of situation is very important for any treatment of palliative case. And I want him not to lose hope and continue with the problem, allopathic problem. And let us see like what will be the outcome of this story. Thanks, everyone. This was a very small case presentation. But more learning at my level. Thank you very much.
Dr. Sunil?
Yes.
time with me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you now.
Okay. So, have you heard what I told just before this?
No, sir, no, nothing, sir. We started hearing only from now, sir.
Okay. So, I was telling that this is more of a reflection regarding this course, what she has learned during these sessions. And maybe I would like to take input from the participants of this course regarding what Dr. Nina has told now and reflected on.
Yes, sir. What you, Dr. Sunil and Dr. Nina, excellent presentation. What you said is very true. This course has really opened our eyes to a lot of things that we did not see earlier. You are right in saying that we have learned, or rather we are learning to spend time and talk with the patients. That does make a lot of difference. And usually in the routine practice, we don't get much time, but only when you sit and talk to them, you establish a rapport with them, then you realize that there is so much they have to tell you. Yes. And initially they are very skeptical, they're very scared, they're very reluctant to open up. So I think building the trust is very important. And that is something which this course has really helped us. And especially a lot of things that Dr. Biju said the other day, it really worked. And personally for me, it has worked really well, really well. I'm so happy that I am in this in course at this moment. And I think all of us are going to be better human beings than better physicians in once this is over. That's all I have to say.
Dr. Sunil, we can't hear you, sir. Still no, sir.
How is it now?
Yes, sir, it is okay.
Okay, I was telling that creating or making a rapport with the patient is the most important thing. And if you know how to make rapport with the patient, then maybe 50 to 60% of our job is over. Then as Dr. Gopal used the word, the humanity or better human beings, that's what we are. And we have to learn how to become a human. We are doctors, but still we are human beings. So it is very important. Anybody else want to comment?